Okay, so we're going to start learning about intimacy again. Obviously, that's the concept and what we're all about here. We're also talking about doing things in a real legit way. Like we're talking about superstars. We just talk about, you know, Tyson, the whole fight with Fury. I mean, not Fury. He'd be destroyed by Fury. But with what's his name?
Jake
Paul. With that whole thing. So Netflix season, you know, like these big specials. So we're talking about Elvis as well, like the people who have a gift and talent and how it can sometimes sort of get turned into just pure money making. It loses its purpose. And we're going to tie that into the intimacy, because part of intimacy is getting real, like realizing that life gets real. Once again, my son's headed off to Lebanon. He's gone in all the way in, far in. And he is now part of the unit of San Khanim, which is the most experienced unit in that whole part of the army. And so therefore there's a lot of responsibility on them, but they're also the most tired because they've been fighting for more than a year in Azza and Lebanon, and they're just exhausted. So we really need to like pray for them, and we really need to have them in mind. Life gets pretty real, and that's what in the end like pushes out some of the talent in these people. And unfortunately, that wasn't so real with the Tyson thing, because it didn't get down to that feeling where they really went for it, you know? You didn't see Tyson come in like he used to, all the way in, to lay those punches. Yeah, he rigged. And with UFC, you see like the people are really going for it, like fully.
Yeah.
And that's one of the reasons why it's become, in some ways, bigger than boxing, and all the big stars are involved in it. You saw like who came. And funny enough, I got my pro Trump T-shirt on when some gave it.
Trump loves UFC.
Yeah, it's a certain awakening, and this is connected to what we're going to learn today about the masculine energy. I don't know if you talked about this in B'nai Akiva. But bless you, because we are the world B'nai Akiva crew, intimacy boys, and we need to talk about masculine energy. That's something which went into like sort of bless you went into hiding a little bit. There was a few rebels, we've mentioned some of their names, bless you, these past few weeks. People that, you know, like came out and fought against the wokest, sort of leftist, sort of downplay of men energy. And in order for us to be successful in intimacy, we're going to have some of that men energy. Now, it doesn't have to go, as we've mentioned before, as far as, say, someone like Andrew Tate or some of these other guys, Dan, and all these guys who go too far and funny enough, they've ended up hating us as people as well, become anti-Semitic. So they went too far down that road of the masculine energy where it sort of takes over, becomes toxic. But we have to find that balance where it's healthy and channeled and gives ability for us to be able to have intimacy, to be able to be present, to be with a woman and value her and appreciate her in the right time, in the right way, with the right person. And that's part of what we've been learning about. So today's class is all about review. It's really reviewing everything we've done since we started. And, you know, I was going to mention, we were talking about talents and stars. So I just want to give an example of the opposite path. It's always good to sometimes learn from what not to be. Our friend here mentioned Elton John, yeah?
Yeah.
So Elton John was one of the people who managed to sort of stick it out in the music business. There are a few who survived. It's literally a survival. Either the talent destroys them, the drugs, the sex, the rock and roll. They don't know how to like be balanced, or they don't have the right management. They don't know how to channel that genius in them in a healthy way, in a long-term way. And they end up crashing and burning, most of them. But Elton John somehow, even though he had his crash and burn moments, but he managed to stick it out. One of the ways is he got involved with the recovery world, which is a very important path. And that will help us with the whole intimacy path. Also, the recovery world has a lot of insight into this area. I've personally seen it with my own eyes, like sex addicts and gambling addicts. It's all very connected, the same kind of point of why they're addicted and how to heal it somewhat. And this is something which Elton John very much was involved with. And the personal story is, I heard on my last trip to London, was it last trip or maybe two trips before that? I was driving around with my dad, and I'm actually going to London tomorrow, so I'm going to be there till next time's class. So next time's class, please get everyone to come, because we really want to end off with a bang, make sure everybody gets something out of this. you know, this is my way of giving over what I feel will benefit you for your life, not just for like, well, B'nai Akiva. This is like life lessons. So to get back to Elton John, so I was driving around with my dad, and he says he had a dinner with Elton John. My uncle was there, Harvey Goldsmith, a famous impresario, and they were there to basically take on Elton John's business. That was the offer on the table. And his management came, his manager came, and if you've watched the Netflix thing, Rocket Man, is that what it's called?
Yeah.
So he's in, the manager is in that as well. It's a pretty crazy guy. Anyway, they came to meet my father and uncle. This wasn't in the documentary, in this moment. If you look at the George Michael one, my family in that documentary, there's certain ones that they appear, like Live, Bohemian Rhapsody, those kinds of ones. But Elton John not, and one of the, they did do work together. I mean, he was at Live Aid, he did appear in events that my family did, but they never took him on full time as one of their main acts. And this is why, because they were sitting at the table, and Elton and the manager had what's called, I think the word my father used was, not playboys, but like paid boys, or there's some sort of English slang name for these kind of guys. But they're basically young guys who are basically rented out to do what they want with.
Rent boys.
Rent boys. That's the thing, is it? Rent boys.
You're familiar with that?
Rent boys. So they, Elton and his manager rented out rent boys. And you could do that, that's fine. But this is my uncle sitting there with my dad and my mother and my auntie. You know, they come from very like normal families, like even somewhat upper class families. And my grandmother was had a house in Bishop's Avenue. And, you know, we're not like nobodies, yeah? So like, you don't just sit there and like bring your rent boys to the table in this fancy restaurant. But they did. And not only that did they bring them, but they made them start to do stuff at the table in front of my... And it was like my dad and my uncle were looking at each other. My auntie and my mum were like, this is disgusting. Like, what is going on? I remember this is like the 60s or something, like in the 60s, maybe early 70s. And that, even that, like, that was just too much. So they said to him, like, this is too much. Like, sorry, we can't carry on this discussion and dinner anymore. And they looked incredulous because they were just living that life, you know, rock and roll, baby, you know. And they were not happy about it, my family, and they left that, and that was the end of business with each other. That was the one time they were about to do business, and they didn't. Now, what happened soon after that was a massive scandal that the rent boys came out publicly in the press about what the manager and Elton had been doing to them, and abuse or whatever it was. Huh? Yeah, but it was like, it was too much for the world, for such famous people to do it so publicly. And to be so like in people's face about it, you do this stuff, you do it privately, yeah. But they just didn't at that time. That was not like gonna go down. So anyway, so that's an example of the opposite, where the business, and you can ask Elton himself. I'm sure I can't 100% vouch for him, but now he comes across as a more like family man, supporting charities, and you know, he's on the right side now. He's still gay, but he's at least doing it in a proper way, as they would say, yeah? Society would approve, you know? But the point is that with intimacy, it's not about, once again, public opinion. You're not famous. But it is about, at least like, to my family's credit, like they had standards and they were together, agreed upon that this was too far. And there's going to be situations in intimacy. We're going to be in private, but there's things that go too far. There's going to be experiences which go too far. But to go back to all the way to the beginning of the class, where we started off, most of the problem in our generation is, and you guys say it's not that way with you guys, because maybe you're in a better place and you're in a better program, but and you have better families maybe, but online and the way the world comes across, because online always tells you the most worst examples generally, people are not interacting, are not hooking up, are not getting intimate. Like there's a problem, yeah? And it's affecting hundreds of thousands of maybe even millions of people in their procreation, and the next generation is in certain countries are having a massive birth problem, and they're not having any more children like they used to. And this is like a global issue now. And if you bring it to us in World B'nai Akiva, that brings us to the first class. We talked about ponema, like actually connecting to the person, being proactive, getting out there and meeting with people and creating relationships. You know, during Corona, we had a big step back from that because of everything that happened. Everyone went online and somewhat stayed online with the apps and with how everything's being done. And one of the things we mentioned is how important it is to interact. Now, the good thing news by you guys is apparently you are doing that. You're not just relying on DMs and texting, sexting. You're not relying on that way of communication. You're not getting totally pulled in now. We haven't yet hit the full impact of the new AI bots. I don't know if you've been getting them on your feed. Have you getting them? Yeah, they're already starting to come, like AI girlfriends, and it's starting to happen. There's even people who've killed themselves already from those relationships. I don't know how they, it's like, it's been documented already by, you know, there's a group. I don't know if you ever saw that Netflix thing called Social Dilemma. You ever saw Social Dilemma?
No, I've heard of it.
Yeah, so this guy there, he's now running a whole massive organization. They're a little bit borderline political, I hope not, but they've got involved. They're very much involved with the Dems, but hopefully now that Trump's back in and Elon Musk and those kind of people are around, they'll reconfigurate themselves towards the more free press way of doing things, like freedom of speech and stuff. But they have to figure out, because they're creating this whole movement which is trying to monitor the effect the internet's having on our interactions as humanity, which connects to the intimacy point. Because if it's getting so extreme that people are getting addicted to all these algorithms and online apps, and even to the point where AI is starting to fill in the space for relationship needs, which is a big danger. Yeah, you don't want to be talking to an algorithm and having a relationship with an algorithm. You want to be, especially in this course, you want to be able to have human interaction. You want to find that other half. You're not going to find her on a screen, but you'll find an illusion of it, an imagination of it. It will stimulate all those points that you think you'll get out of this relationship, but it won't be the full, real experience, especially if you believe in spirituality and having a soul. It has no soul, has no purpose, these interactions, other than just titillation or you know, et cetera, et cetera. So there is a whole movement now trying to monitor that kind of stuff. And see if they can somewhat control it, and with government and this and policy. But that can also get risky, because then it gets involved with freedom of speech, which we don't want to get removed. Really, what it comes down to, if you say, if you're fans of Rogan, yeah, you guys like Rogan,
yeah.
With Rogan, for example, he's very strong on you have to make your own choice. And I also somewhat agree with that. Like, the Torah gives us freedom of choice, Bechira. It tells us what to choose, but it wants us to choose. It doesn't. You don't have like a rabbi or a court of justice standing there beating you up if you don't do everything the Torah says. Well, not at least at this stage, historically. So the point is that you have to choose. You have to have freedom of choice. And the power of choice, being proactive in choosing to interact with relationships and choose to react in a way, not react, but to proactively connect to another person in a real way, this is going to lead to the first level of intimacy. You can't get into a relationship without communication and interaction, and that means positive interaction, it means initiating, it means going out of your comfort zone and making connections. I know myself, I'm at a point where I can run a lot of my business online and do a lot online, but there's nothing better than when I actually get out. Like, I went to a wedding the other day, I made a new booking contact with a band, Solomon Brothers. We hadn't done work together for years. It reminded me I need to reach out to the head of the original head of the Moshe band, Yehuda Solomon, who I actually just saw last night, Hanan Ben Ari, like Kumzit in Rav Shlomo Katz's house. Like, you know, if I don't get out, I don't get these interactions. If I sit at home and just do everything, it's like a different level of connection than just on the machine. And now I'm going to England, so I'm going to have an opportunity to meet lots and lots of people, and I'm excited about it. You know, I need to do more of that here as well when I get back. But the point is that interaction, it leads to things really taking place, and it always will be the key to business and to success, that you're able to go and be in front of people. And that's the same, even more so with a lady, with a woman. Like, you're going to have to go out of these screens, out of these profiles, out of these styles, out of the DMs, and actually go and interact, create positive situations, and develop relationships. That's the first level. Second level, I challenge you all, second habit, I challenge you all to start having goals. You have goals? Anyone's written down anything? Like, it was weeks ago already. How long ago? It was like in August or something, or September.
Well, in terms of like within a relationship.
Yeah, goals or even your own goals. You have to know yourself. Because in the end, when one of the things that's going to help you get into a relationship, we've talked about this, is matching your goals and your dreams and your visions with another person. Yeah, one of the things that helps my wife and I, is my soulmate, is that we're constantly working out our goals and our dreams, our vision for the future. You know, right now we're visualizing my son coming back safely from Lebanon. We're visualizing we're moving house. When we move house, it's going to be much closer to the community we're in. And we're going to be able to host more because people come visit all the time. We'll be right next to the community. And, you know, last night, instead of driving to the event, I could have just walked to the event.
Yeah, you know,
and in fact, I live in the Dekel and I'm going to move, please God, to the Zayat, Hanukkah. So I'm very excited for that. Like, we have visual, we talk out these things and it creates goals and we're on a journey together. And if you don't know your goals, you don't have, then how can you really have your destination and your journey? It's sort of a little bit, sort of whatever. And then if you're not matching up and you're not joining together in those kind of conversations, what are you talking about? It's just, you know, right now, well, we'll go out here, we'll go out there. But after a certain point, if it's not like a sort of larger vision of your relationship and your journey together, everything starts to dry up a little bit and it loses a sort of excitement. What keeps it exciting is you know that you're doing this together. Your soulmates are going to grow old together. You're going to have moments where different stages of life you're going to experience. And one of the best things about having a relationship, and this is what a lot of people are suffering because they don't have it, is when you come home or you experience something's powerful, you have someone come home and share it with. Yeah, or you have someone you can phone up and share it with. Yeah, you can message them and be in touch. You can send pictures that appreciate what you're going through. Like, I'm sure, like, you on this trip to Israel, you've been sharing some of your highlights to your family and friends. And it makes more meaning to those experiences because they were more profound. But if you don't have a wife, a soulmate in the journey of life, because that's the person who's going to always be there with you. In the end of the day, the parents, the children, the friends, they might not always be there with you, and they probably won't. But your wife, your soulmate, if you both get to live long lives together, you're going to be together all the way. They're going to know you from when you were a young man all the way through to old age. They're going to know your middle age and all the different funny things that went on. They're going to have, you know, context. For me, it's great because, as I told you in my story when I met my wife, and we were blessed as a soulmate, that she was someone who was part of my teenage years. So she knew me when I was hanging out in London. She has all that context of the clubs and the bars and the pool and the balls and all the things I went to and I was running or involved with, and she was invited and my house parties. She's got all that context, so it's really good. So when I go back to London, for example, she knows all my crew. So it's really fun. She's like already knows who I'm seeing and, you know, and she's already excited for me as well to go have those experiences. Ideally, she'll come with me, but this trip, because of my son in Lebanon, like, she can't leave Israel. She just won't. She can't leave knowing he's in such a, you know, you understand that, yeah? But like the concept of experiencing something together with someone is really powerful and profound. It takes away loneliness. It takes away depression in some ways. It gives much more excitement, especially when you have goals and dreams and vision of what your life is about. And you're living it. You're manifesting it. It's happening. And you're going through these moments. Like I said, I'm visualizing my son coming home. We're going to celebrate. I spoke to a friend today. I'm already visualizing. We're going to make another kind of like event like they did last night. And we're going to invite Hanan Ben Ari. We're going to invite Shlomo Katz, invite Nissen Black. But all the people that we're connected with. And have a really powerful experience with my sons. With his son. His son was one of the sons who flew the drone to kill Sinema. That famous video where you see them throwing the stick at it. You saw that one? That's my friend's son. And then another son. I don't know if he was involved in something as famous as that footage, but you know, we've all got kids in these situations. We can't wait to celebrate, and we're visualizing it, and that's the visualization we want, not the, God forbid, the knock on the door or all the negative stuff that you see in the news. We want to visualize the positive, and that's in relationship as well, and that's why it's important to have dreams and goals, to really look forward to your future. And it gives you much more energy now. You're drawing off these dreams and these goals to live a more like great life. And one of the things is, at the end of the day, as Stephen Covey cleverly says, end in mind. You're going to have to, after 120, they're going to give you a hesped. They're going to talk about you. What did you do? What did you accomplish? So how much you were on the phone, TikToking, not going to feature. Yeah, unless you were an influencer and changing people's lives, which can happen, but most of us are not. So if you're not doing that, so what, all that hours of all kinds of things are just wasted time. So that brings us to the next point of the class is living time effectively. Time is the biggest gift, using it to be effective, and that comes in relationships of being able to be present and focused. For me, that's one of the hardest things. I told you my probably my two hardest ones are listening and being focused. They're probably very connected, but time is a big part of that. Time management, how to prioritize. So that, once again, if you've got the goals and dreams and you know who you are and you're interacting with this person, or you're already doing the first two points we said. So this third point of time management and being effective in relationships is already now in a good place because you have the goals, you have the dreams, you know what you want to put your time into, you're prioritizing it. I'm building my booking business, I'm building my marketing business, I'm building my classes with Walt Bnei Akiva and other people, and you know, these are my priorities in terms of my talents and skills. You know, this is like what I want to focus my time on. You're gonna have to figure out what is your time now. Obviously you're still young, but as you grow, you change and update your goals. If you write it now, you can review it. And that's part of this session today, is about learning to review, sharpening the saw, reviewing it, and changing it, updating it, evaluating again and again, what are my goals, and then being more effective at achieving it and executing it. One of the biggest things that people struggle with is they're not able to execute their dreams. You have dreams. You want to be, let's be real, we're not going to be a football star, yeah? Most of us Jewish boys, yeah? There's like one Jewish player, I think, in the whole, not even in the Premier, I think he's in like... Yeah, there's one dude, yeah? I listened to a podcast from the other day. Sounds like a cool guy. He's been dealing with anti-Semitism recently. He's been fighting it. He didn't even want to get involved in it, but he got pulled into it just by being a Jew, which is another thing that's going on right now. We have to realize we're being pulled by our Jewishness into all kinds of things, and it's unavoidable at this point. So you might like, I was just talking to the management of Rudy Rochman, and they were saying that in the US, there's become so many activists now. So what Rudy used to do on all the campuses was like a chiddush, now like a new idea, but now it's like there's hundreds of people doing it because it's got to the point where it's like part of reality. So then people are stepping up to deal with it. But he was ahead of the story already. He was doing it years ago before it became so publicized. But anyway, the point is to come back to being prioritizing on your application of your goals. These are really powerful tools in relationship. And that brings you to the, once you've done all that internal work, you've got yourself sorted out, now you can start achieving success with that other person. Now you can start going public with this relationship. That doesn't mean changing your status on your feed or the, you know, profile, whatever. I'm in a relationship. Maybe it does. But the main point is you can now go public with her, the other person, because you're in a better focused place. You know who you are. You know what she's about. You're prioritizing her. And now you can start to succeed in your life. That means relationships. That means, for example... Yeah, let's. What would you say? I'm going to ask you guys now. What would you say would be your victory? How would you win in a relationship? What would be your success? What would you want? A good lay? I don't know. You tell me. Yeah, a nice night out, trip to Bahamas.
Depends what relationship is.
Yeah.
And like, I don't know, if you're just like speaking to them, like the victory could be like being in a relationship with them.
That in itself is already an achievement. Yeah. Nowadays, just to have a relationship and be able to be consistent and get to know each other and not be like constantly fighting, and that is already a big level. It's quite a low bar, you know.
The balls to like ask her out or something and her saying yes, that's a victory.
Yeah, that's the first level. You can't really go anywhere until you've engaged and committed on some level. So yeah, so you have to do that. But now you're with each other. Now, how do you have victory? I mean, obviously, there's levels. You know, if you're getting married and you're having children, and these are all big victories and all these big, you know, big times in life where you're accomplishing huge moments of children and all the children go through and all the simchot and the way it impacts your family and your community, all those moments, and you're able to, Baruch Hashem, celebrate with people all these big stages in life. But now, what would you say relationship-wise between you and her is a success? Like, that you've been able to go through struggles, you've been able to get to know each other better, you start to help her succeed in her life. Because remember, she also has goals and dreams. that's part of what we discussed, to help her succeed. And one of the things women for sure are going to do, they're going to try and nurture you. Now, it has to be careful that they don't overdo it. You don't want them to be overly involved in your life. You want them to have like, yeah, like it can be very overburdening. Like when you feel like they're like too opinionated of everything you do. That's not fun. That's not a victory. That's not a good relationship. That's something's off. She's overly nurturing and you're overly like needing or overly not taking care of all the things she's saying. So there has to be some sort of middle ground where you're both working together and you are believing in her, she's believing in you, and it's more positively focused. That's the point. Because we can definitely easily be critical of another person. Everyone's got issues. But the focus has to be, how can you help build each other? That's something which women can struggle with. And, you know, we mentioned in the beginning the masculine energy and the feminine energy. The feminine energy can get very overwhelming for a man, where they feel suffocated. I don't know if you get that sometimes to your mother, but you feel like it's just too much. You know, like, just give me a space. I need to do my thing. I need to tell you everything. Everything I'm doing. Like, there has to be this balance of respect and believing in each other, and each person has their own purpose and their own thing they're into and their own crew, and that you can't be overly involved in each other's space. There's that balance, those boundaries. And that, once again, like, then you can really build each other, because she's going to have what she wants to dream and succeed in, and you're going to have yours. And the point is, you both encourage each other. That's going to be something which a lot of people are going to struggle with, because there's a lot of competitive energy in relationships. Women have become maybe a bit more competitive than they ever were. So you're going to start to feel like, wait a minute, she's like showing her masculine energy too much. And that's making me feel like, you know, not so good about myself. And that's a problem where a lot of is going on society-wise, where a lot of men are feeling insecure and depressed and not feeling fulfilled. And then they get caught up with all the things you mentioned earlier on, the addictions and all the not good stuff, because they're not fulfilling their purpose or fulfilling their purpose. They're not getting the recognition from their soulmate. So that often there's a lot of back and forth that needs to go, and a relationship needs a lot of interaction to heal that stuff. And the main goal, once again, is to be supportive. To not be overly critical, but be overly supportive. But not overly supportive, but more supportive than critical, definitely. And that's the once again, it's going to be the same with kids. It's going to carry through to everything. With business, you want the other person to succeed, not just you. You want to be in a win-win. Wherever you are, everyone around you is succeeding. You're in the winning team. Yeah, just being a Jew already, you're winning. Yeah, just being born into our people. You're already, as they call it, a privileged. I don't call it privileged. I call it a gift. We have a gift and responsibility. And we have ability to make a big impact, all of us. We have resources, we have internal resources, we have a tradition, we have a nation. There's so much that we're given already off the bat, that when I went to public school, or state school, they call it in England, a lot of those guys didn't have all that stuff. Yeah, their mother was smacking them around the face and they had teeth missing, and they had, you know, they were getting abused or beaten up or who knows what was going on. Financially, didn't have the steps ahead. There was a lot of things missing that I, thank God, grew up not missing. And we have to use that as a responsibility to live a better life. And that is part of, in a relationship, we mentioned in London, there's going to be standards. People are going to choose people that are on a standard. They're going to marry, like in England, you wouldn't marry a council estate girl. Agreed? Yeah?
Yeah.
You just wouldn't. What would you call her? Slag? I don't know what, yeah?
Chav.
Well, maybe it's snobbery, maybe it's wrong. Maybe there's some amazing council state girls. You know, once again, you have to be open-minded in this generation. You never know. There's some people who can build themselves from the lowest place and become the biggest success in all ways. It's not always like a general clear, but there is still standards. And some people, unfortunately, if we mentioned already, you want to be with a woman who somewhat matches your culture and your vision and your goals, and you know there's a sort of, so already a certain understood level that you're going to aim for. Agreed. And you're going to be in those circles. Agreed. Like, you're not hanging out. Like, when I started making that transition, my past, I went to a state school. For some reason, my parents sent me to a state school. They financially didn't need to, but they did. And
what did you go to?
I went to Edgware State School. Pretty rough, yeah? Like, people were, when I left, were already stabbing and, like, hardcore stuff. People were going to prison. As I once told the story, I went back for Shabbos and stayed by my uncle. I'm actually eating at this uncle. And the house he lived in was the house of the richest boy in the school. My uncle lives in this richest boy's house. And we're going to eat by him the Shabbos, or not the Shabbos, the next Shabbos in Edgware. So he lives in this house. I was there for one Shabbos. I actually slept there. And that Shabbos, the police came around and were looking for the boy from the family, from the best kid of the school. They were looking for him. And they came and knocked on this address because that was his old address. And that's what he gave them. He gave them his old address, probably when life was better. And he was like one of the best kids. So they were pretty rough kids, let's be honest, yeah, in Edgware State. Now they've done all kinds of, what do they call it, gentrification, where they like improved all the council estates.
And
I grew up in Edgware.
Sorry to hear that.
Sorry, yeah. Well, I mean, it's changed a lot. It's much better now. Maybe not better, but it's still better than it was. And yeah, anyway, so to come back to, so I grew up with that. And then when I had that transition of starting getting into the Jewish world, like through Brady Maccabi or whatever it was I went to as a kid, all these different youth movements my parents sent me. And that was my big question. Why was I drawn to Jewish boys and Jewish girls when I was in a public state school system, which I was one of the only Jews there was, yeah? So how did I make that transition? That was a very interesting transition. The bit by bit, I started being drawn like a magnet towards the Jewish crew, and the non-Jewish crew I got less and less crewed with. So it was like an instinctive thing that even though against the odds, because I was put in a place where I was the only Jew almost, I still found my way towards all the Jewish crew. And the same happened in university as well. Met all the key Jewish players there in Sussex. And, you know, it was again and again. And that was my big question when I came to Israel. Why am I Jewish? And what does this mean to me? Why am I always being drawn towards the Jewish people? And whenever I was with non-Jews, I have some pretty crazy stories where they turned on me. Yeah, I didn't even do anything, but they just turned on me, beat me up. Yeah, I was probably anti-Semitic underneath. But I was in Colindale Park, for example, with all my non-Jewish friends. But I was with my crew. I was just like them, maybe dressed a bit nicer as a Jew boy, but I was with my crew. And, you know, we were walking around and they were walking around and this whole crew came up and they literally pinned down all my friends and with bricks and they set this Irish kid on me.
That sounds like
fun. And he just started knocking into me, my face. I think a few teeth came out. He's like beating me. And none of my boys could do anything because there was more of them. They specifically waited for half our crew to leave and then they came on us. And so I ran back to this house. I was by all these drunk, you know, whatever, Greek people that I was friends with and black and Greek. And they came down to the park to look for them afterwards, to beat them up, all these big guys. Anyway, I found out later on that they got all those people beaten up in the school system of Edgware Senior School. I wasn't in that school. I was already gone off to private school by that point. And they got them all beaten up. And then I went to Burnt Oak and I saw the same crew of boys standing there. And now I was by myself after we got them all beaten up. And I was like, oh my God, I'm going to die. I literally legged it. Yeah. As soon as I saw them, I just ran and ran. And I thank God they probably just couldn't be bothered. They didn't chase me or anything. I just got away from them. And thank God I never saw them again after that. But the point, what I'm getting at is in this whole discussion, sorry, someone's calling me, is that we have to clarify who we are. We know that being Jewish gives us already a level and a standard. And that's going to be again and again with these relationships, who we're going to be with. And it's not just whatever. There is an actual plan and flow with this. So it's part of the victory that we have, that we find someone that can live up to our goals and dreams. And we can build each other to both succeed in that. Then we get to the fifth point we talked about, listening. Now, I have a hard time. I told you, listening is really hard in relationships. I don't know, you guys feel the same. We talked about it at length. Have you found, talking to a lady, a young woman, is difficult? Again and again and again, with all the things they want to talk out, are you interested in it? Do you listen actively? Is it something you care about? Are you engaged?
Depends who says it.
Yeah, I mean, obviously it does depend which kind of girl. Some women are, every woman's different, and some are very interesting and deep and you want to explore. I mean, that's part of what connected me to my wife, is we were already developing a very deep relationship, nothing to do with physicality, just purely just connecting as souls, like talking and talking, all kinds of situations. And that already, when I came to Israel, she also came to Israel, and I realized, you know, maybe she's the one, because like we just have such a deep relationship. And I always wanted to stay connected with her, and I enjoyed her company. Whereas all the other girls, like I enjoyed their physical, you know, connection. I enjoyed, maybe they were like pretty and it was good, like, you know, as they say, I don't want a trophy wife. I want a wife that wins me trophies. You get that line? That's a good line. I don't want a trophy wife. I want a wife that wins me trophies. So I don't want someone I can show off. I want to be with someone who's going to build me. And I'm going to build her. She'll also win trophies. We want to both win together. To be able to do that, you have to be able to listen to each other and enjoy each other's company in a deep way. And that's something which needs to be worked on, because it's hard to really listen, to get rid of your ego and to listen to another person. And then we went to the last point, and that's, we spoke about intimacy itself, and we went into all the details and the idea of connecting. Because really, once you've done all those parts before and you're in a very live and enlivened relationship, like you've connected, you've got similar goals and dreams, you're using your time together well, you're winning together in life, you're joined, you're able to communicate and have deep connection and really empathize and connect, then intimacy is just going to come out of it. Like the idea of like all these rules in Torah of not being alone with a woman and all this stuff, yeah, when it comes to intimacy, when you've done all those steps and it's with the right person, you're for sure going to get intimate. It's not even like now you need all these rules. Like it's a different level now, because you're now just tuned into each other and you're going to want to be intimate. And obviously there's a time and a place and a way, but you're going to be in that moment of connection because you've done all those steps and you didn't just try jump straight to the sexual aspect. Now, as I told you, there are many thought leaders nowadays who are preaching this or teaching it or got, are living it, where they've got into relationships where they're not just getting physical straight away. And it's not a Jewish thing, it's not a religious, maybe it's a, somewhat, if you trace it back, it's maybe from religion, but the point, the concept is they're realizing that if they first start on all the other points of the relationship, then the intimacy and the connection, if they wait for it, will be much more real and it will be with the right person. And that's something which doesn't have to necessarily be a religious concept, it just has to be a reality concept. Because now you're connecting after all that work, you really are ready now to get to know them in a deep way and bond and become one. And that's part of what this goal of this course obviously is, to help us to find that person that we can really deeply connect with and be responsible with and build beautiful homes with and do all the good things that we want to do to make life more meaningful, more purposeful. You know, one of the big things that's changed, like in, just since 2 weeks ago when we last, Trump won the election, yeah, in America. And you'll say, well, yeah, whatever. But that is a big impact, because I don't know if you've noticed, but there's a big message online that wokeism is dead. Have you seen that out there? There's a feeling. Now, we wouldn't have said that if they would have won. Yeah. It's the election somehow was like, which is part of what Trump really represents. He's like a coroner and all that's messed up. He's not going to necessarily solve it all, but he's going to be the one to pronounce it dead. All the crap, all the not good values, all the not good organizations, the not good aspects of government. And he's calling it all out. All the swamp, all the negative in Hollywood and society that's just gone too far. And the world needed a wake up and needed to call it out and say enough already. Yeah, we're not going down this road anymore. It's just going to lead to humans' destruction. There's just too much division. There's no relationships anymore, no marriage, no, you know, all the distortion of relationships is not going to help anybody have happiness. You know, it's getting to a point where on a deep, profound way, people are wanting to get what we've been discussing. People are wanting to shift back to real relationships and intimacy between a man and a woman. And they want to have purpose and goals, and they don't want to become victims. They want to succeed. They want to be able to accomplish. and be, get recognition from it, not have the government screw up the whole system of accomplishment where people get rewarded for not even doing anything. Yeah, there's a whole switcheroo going on with people wanting to get returned back to truer ways of being and life. And it hasn't impacted everywhere. It's not the whole world, but it's definitely a big push in that direction. Those voices, like the legacy media that was going that other way, is no longer becoming the strong voice. And the independent media, the independent musicians, the independent stars, and the independent studios, and all that's independent, where they're not agenda-ridden. I don't know where this whole negative agenda came from. It seemed like it came from the devil or something, but it's all lost its somewhat its power. And now there's an opportunity for us as young people and people within our own choices in life to live a more purposeful life and to get the world in a better place than where it's heading. And that should give us some inspiration in relationships, because now there's more of a strength in, yeah, looking for one person, and yeah, building a home, and yeah, family values are important, and it's not just hookup culture. That didn't really work. Even you ask the kings of the hookup culture, they don't even agree with it that much anymore after doing it for 10 years and being famous on Instagram and everything else. They themselves, if you talk to them, they themselves would say that it went too far. Yeah. So what we got to realize is that this is now an opportunity for us to like really, and as a people as well, as the Jewish people, we're in the homeland, we have our own nation, we're actually now fighting back. We're not being victims, we're not trying to be politically like swami, we're actually getting down to fulfilling our purpose as a people and making sure that we're defending ourselves, and we're going even on the offense where it needs to. It's things are starting to change. Like someone told me the other day, just if you want to get a little bit political, but in the army, for example, they're starting to get nervous that there's too much of a change going on in the army. So they want to start reining in on this whole like right wing or whatever they call it, like more pro-Israel, like pro-war kind of seemingly pro, you know, fighting mindset. And they want to bring it back in, back to the old lefty, like peace with the Arab kind of head. But it's gone too far now. Like nobody's going back to that. Things have changed. We're in a changed world. And whatever they would try and do is not going to work, because it's the culture, the reality, people experientially are changed. And that's so too with relationships. People are changed. And that's my hope, for example, this whole AI bot thing and all the stuff that's coming up technologically, that people will have the strength inside of them to still want real relationships. They're not just going to settle for these fake, you know, sex toys and sex robots and all this coming stuff. They're not going to settle for it. I don't think it's going to, unless people are going to become lazy again, I'm optimistic that we're going to fight for relationships. The whole aspect of fighting for things needs to come back to our people, where we fight for our independence, we fight for our security, we fight for our well-being, we fight for our family. That comes back to the masculine energy of one of the things of being a provider and fighting for this person. You have to be willing to fight for her. If you try to think that she's just going to stay with you just because you're a nice guy, yeah, or you've got like some hookups from family or whatever it is, you think you can sort of blag it. Most relationships aren't going to stay. You have to fight for it. You have to fight for relationships now. That means it's a different reality where we have to really be engaged and really fight for what we want and what we believe in, fight to provide. Yeah, it's going to be a bit more of a fight now to get Panasa, to bring an income. In the end, it's all from Hashem, but we have to do what we have to do to fight for it. We have to try in our own way to make a change that our relationships are improved and the higher level experiences, and we can't allow ourselves to sort of fall into this sort of like apathetic, you know, it will be okay, like it was okay by my family and be okay by my family's family, you know, their parents and their parents. We're just riding off the wave, like North London Jews, where I come from, we've all done the same thing. We've all gone to university, we all got a job, we're all married, we've all got kids, we all go to the David Lloyd and we go, you know, to Spain once a year. You know, everyone's got, or whatever it is nowadays, people travel a bit more, but whatever it is, it's not like that now. There's going to be a challenge on us just being so-so whatever people. We're going to have to actually face up to our relationships are under attack. Yeah, like if you're not fully engaged in creating a great intimate life, you will be engaged in other things. in whether you want to be or not. There's no, it's like Gedalia Fenster, this guy I listened to who I mentioned, the trophy wife, you rather choose a wife to build you trophies. He said a good line. He said, there's no such thing as having space for just to do whatever. Either you're going to live a very full-on, like David Goggins, like accomplished day, or in relationship-wise, you know, Shalom Bias, like Avram and Sarah from the Parsha, or Yitzhak and Rivka, like from our tradition, or you're going to have a day where you're just properly just wasting time. And not only that, you're probably doing bad things. Yeah, and like, for example, the whole idea of seed, we mentioned it in this intimacy-focused session, of seed. Seed is often is very connected with time wasting. And the internet sort of tuned into that with all the apps and all the porn and it. We spoke about porn. That whole thing is very connected to wasting time. Killing time is very connected to killing your power, your potential, your ability to create. And that is something which, once again, we have to retune into. I don't want my amazing power and potential to be wasted on nonsense. I want to use it to impact. I want to use it to impact my relationship, impact my wife, impact my children. Fine, we're in a world where we need entertainment on some level. But be like clever about it. Be like effective about it. Maybe even do it together. That would be a good idea. One of the things I try and do is save my entertainment for my chill time with my wife, with my girl, you know, my soulmate. Try and use those entertainment needs to entertain together, not just privately, not just in your own space. Like, it's like, you know, Rogan always says, I have to earn the right to be able to chill. That means a full day of hard work, whatever that is, working out, doing my commitments, being responsible, and then I can earn the right to chill at the end of the day. Whereas a lot of people now would just want Netflix chill 24/7, yeah? That's not going to give you any feeling of fulfillment, and you're wasting your life, your ability, and that is part of weakening that intimate connection with your other person, because you've got nothing to give. Think about it. If you spend all 6 days of the week working really hard on everything you need to do, on your relationships, on your income, on your talents, all the things we spoke about, you're full on, you're game on, and we're going to talk about that at the end class, getting our game on, getting really like fired up for these concepts. If we really, and I want you guys to bring stuff, I'm going to mention it in the chat. I want you guys to bring questions. I want you guys to bring your game. So I'm not just sitting here talking. I want you guys to tell me how you feel you're going to, between a guy and a girl, and between your program here and everything you're trying to do in life, how your game's more turned on, how you're on a more enhanced version of yourself than when you came at the beginning of the year. You don't want to just come here and leave the same you when you came, or even worse. You want to come here like a new level. I learned Hebrew better. I understand Israel better. I met some really cool people that are going to be my friends for life. You know, you want to come out with accomplishments. I learned from amazing teachers. All this stuff. And when you've got all that inside of you, and we mentioned intimacy, one part of intimacy is you're downloading it into the other person. Now, if you've got a bunch of crap inside you and you're downloading that into your other person, and then she's crap because of you. I mean, you don't make her crap completely, but she's less of a person because you're less of a husband, and everyone's less because the children you create are less. Everything's less because what you filled yourself up with is crap. It's just like, it's just logical. Like, if you think about it on a physical level, if you eat, drink, and well, and you work out, and you do all the different things you need to do, so your body and everything, then you're able to live a more effective, energized life. Yeah, so too with the relationship. You have to energize your relationship. You have to see yourself as someone who's a source of energy for this other person on some level, and you're pouring good energy into that other person so they can go do their thing, fully energized, and your children as well. Everyone's energized. The whole home, we're just building energy. And you come to Shabbat, you come to the seventh day, and you disconnect from all the world, you disconnect from everything, and it's just you, your wife, your kids, and the community around you, and you're fully engaged. At the Shabbat meals, you're fully engaged in internalizing what happened this week. You're communicating to each other, you're talking it out. The whole Shabbat experience is all about internalization of what the week was and building for the new week to come. And also, even more important, it's just being present now in the middle of it and just experiencing life on the highest level, and experiencing family life, experiencing a relationship life, experiencing the idea of intimacy. Ideally, in the Torah, intimacy, the best time is Shabbat. because everything else is now removed. It's just you and your spouse. It's you and your soulmate. That is the time now to bring, download the 6 days, the 6 points we mentioned before, into this seventh reality. Seventh reality is the concept, if you go Kabbalistically, if you want to go mystical, it's the concept of Malchus. You're receiving all the energy from the week and you're bringing it to build a beautiful Shabbat experience. So you can have a beautiful table, you have a beautiful home, you have a beautiful family. This is what the 6 days, the 6,000 years of creation is all about. Yeah, this whole 6,000 years is us working hard in exile and all kinds of situations as a Jewish people to be able to come to the Yom Shikud Shabbos, to come to the time where we're ultimately, intimately one with God. This is how spiritual this concept is. It's not just whatever. If you start to understand that, there is a Mashiach coming, there's a Shabbat coming, Eretz Yisrael. We're sitting in the seventh land. We're sitting in Eretz Yisrael. This is the land which receives all the work of our people. So that then we can live off the blessings of this land. But we have to work hard to get to those blessings. Now, will those blessings come either way? Probably Shabbat comes every week anyway, whatever you do. That's one of the gifts of Hashem. But wouldn't it be better to come fully in your game than sort of, as we mentioned, half-assing your relationship? Like, you want to be able to have a full relationship. You want to have a full vessel. You want to be able to give over full energy to the people around you. Same with me, like I need to work on this myself. I'm just saying to you guys, this is like a different level of being a husband or being a boyfriend, whatever relationship it is, or being a man. You want to be a man who believes in yourself and wins and succeeds. Like that's what's going on right now. There's a victory of men again, finally. It was like everyone was, I don't know what was going on, they were asleep or something. Men are coming out again and saying, no, enough, I want to win. Israel's saying, I want to win. I don't want to be like making these fake peace agreements that mean nothing and the enemy still wants to kill us at the end of it. I want to have real long-term peace. How? Through victory, through winning and fighting. And that's something, you know, the army now, my son, they're tired. But part of the reason they're tired is because they're not getting that energy for when they come back. They're coming back to us and we're like living life like this war's not happening. We're just sort of coasting along, back to Netflix, back to cinema, back to wherever we're doing with our day life. And they see what they're fighting for. Like, this is why I'm fighting, almost killing myself every day. Some of them are getting killed, God forbid. And it's for this bunch of clowns, you know, like, sorry to be rude about us, but we're living like clowns. We have to be full on. And that's the same with a woman. A woman's going to respect a man who's fully in his game. Fully, you get what I'm saying? I went a long way on this because I think it's really important. And God put it into my head to talk about this in such a strong way because I think our generation needs to hear it more than ever. We need to be fully engaged, fully empowered, fully involved. And all the tintillating phone crap, it's not going to fill us up. It's not going to give us purpose. We have to get to a point where we start fighting back on every level of our life. And that's including fighting for our relationships. Fighting for our relationship with our parents, for our relationship with our friends. If you're going to be lazy, there's going to be filled up. The space is going to get filled. Just it's not going to be filled with goodness. You want to fill up the space with goodness, you have to be engaged. You have to be full on. You have to be involved. And you have to be a proud man, a proud Jewish man. Be really on your game. And all the steps we did before is to build yourself to that kind of person where you have self-esteem. Because you're going to have self-control, you're going to have happiness, because you're going to know that your goals and your dreams and your lifestyle and your use of time is more important to you than these other things. And you're going to start prioritizing things that are really important in your life. And you're going to succeed at them. You're going to master certain aspects of business. You're going to master certain aspects of relationships. You're going to master certain aspects of sports. Whatever it is that gives you fulfillment, you're going to master it. You're not just going to be like, yeah, we might not be football stars, but we can be amazing stars in our essence of who we are because we have other talents. The Jewish people have so much talents. We're not great, the greatest at sports, but plenty of other things we're amazing at. Yeah, we know that. We can do amazing business and we can do amazing, you know, just leading the world in the right way. We can do so much leadership. We can do so much kindness. We can represent kindness in the highest level. There's no kinder people than the Jewish people. It's proven and it's a reality. Every day of this war has been part of our success. One of the things that's given my son so much encouragement and the army so much encouragement is the amount of kindness that goes on. I'm wearing a top here. just one kindness. Yeah, and it says here, meals for heroes. Yeah, just one chesed. The idea of the amount of kindness they've done. Yeah, even Hanan Ben Ari, he's not married now. He got divorced. Yeah. So he's had a hard time on that level. But one of the things he did throughout the war is constantly go around performing for soldiers, giving up his time to perform for soldiers, giving them encouragement that we care about what you're doing. And we're alive and able to function because you're doing the ultimate self-sacrifice. This is part of what our people are about. And this is something which, you know, we'll end off this week's parsha. Eliezer Eved Avraham. I'm called Eliezer. This will be the last point. If anyone has any questions, you can ask me. And next time it's all going to be about you guys. I'm going to say almost nothing. I've said enough. Yeah, so Eliezer Avraham went out on his mission and to find a soulmate for Yitzhak. Yeah, happens to be my oldest daughter's Rivka and my oldest son is Yitzhak. So I'm Eliezer. So I like sort of broke down these souls, Yitzhak and Rivka, brother and sister in this case. But the idea is that we have to realize that there is a shadchan. There is someone who's making soulmates, who's bringing people together. Yeah, we know, according to our tradition, that the Torah says Hashem himself is the one making zavig zavugim. He's bringing souls together all the time. Making, you know, the fact that you end up with that person. My wife came from South Africa to live in London at that time, and I met her at that point through her twin brother and this reason and that reason. And we keep meeting each other at shul and at David Lloyd and this place and that place until we became soulmates in Israel and, you know, one, and it was manifest as a wedding. The whole process, everyone's going to have their soulmate story of how God brought them together. Sometimes it's going to be through a shadchan like Eliezer, Eved Avraham. It's going to be through an agent, through someone who cares about you, who's like, that person's perfect for you. You're going to have a shliach. But the point is, we all need to find someone who's going to help us find that other half. It'll either be a shliach or God, or it could be by us becoming the best we can be, so we attract that to ourselves. But the point is, this week's Parsha, Chai Sarah, is a special segula. So you're in Israel, you're not in London, you're not in New York, you're not in Australia, you're in England. I mean in Israel, excuse me, I'm going to be in England. You're going to be in Israel, I'm going to be in England, you're going to be in Israel. Thank God I already have my soulmate. But you're in a place where you can go to Hebron, you can go and pray, but where it all happened. You're witnessing, this is the land where this shidduch took place in the ultimate sense, that even though he went out of Eretz Yisrael, but he brought back the shidduch and they met. Yitzhak was praying mincha, and you know, the whole experience of the souls meeting. You see in the Torah again and again how it's talked about, and we're going to see also in Parshas Toldos of Yitzhak Yaakov. You can see again and again all the wives of Yaakov. You see again and again how our ancestors came together as soulmates and formed these amazing homes that have brought us all into existence, this amazing people. And you start to realize that that's part of the stories that we're reading right now, is to encourage the power of relationships, of intimacy done right. And you see by Yitzhak the intimacy with Rivka, how profound it was. And it brought down souls. Yeah, it brought down an Esav, but it also brought down a Yaakov. And Esav, you know, also will eventually do tshuva. That's part of what Trump's whole story is. He's Esav doing tshuva, if you want to know what's going on over there. There's a whole underneath story going on. But like, it goes back all the way to the Torah. And it's alive. The point is that there's instruction manual how to get these relationships done. And there's systems and points that I just brought down today, which is a summary of everything we've learned, that will give you the ability to live the best intimate experience. And it's not going to be, you're not going to learn it from the internet, like in the general thing, flow of things. You're generally not. There are a few wise people out there, a few good relationship guides here and there who say, make some sense. And there maybe are some helpful tools, like, you know, dating apps and stuff could be there helpful. I've met people on those apps and have, Baruch Hashem, happy homes. Could be there's some good going on through the internet. And ultimately, we have to use the internet for good also. But we have to realize that the real game is going to come down to us living it, making it happen, and bringing it to life. That's it. Have a good one. Any questions, please bring next time. And bring more boys. Everyone needs to come in. I'm going to be energized from England, and I've got a lot to share after 2 weeks there.